Many people who run institutions are fundraisers. In raising funds, we go to whichever avenue is most convenient. The avenues are primarily people who have abundance of money, who can help support institutions of higher learning or institutions of Jewish function, Jewish welfare. The Lubavitcher Rebbe and the previous Lubavitcher Rebbe also engaged in similar activities. In 1929, the Lubavitcher Rebbe, who had been exiled from Russia for defying the communists and was saved by miracle, came to these blessed shores in order to determine whether America was ready for a Lubavitcher yeshiva and to raise funds for such a yeshiva. He was promised great things by his followers who lived here, but they predicated most of their commitments based upon the activities of the stock market. They were successful businessmen who had invested in the stock market and were going to give the Rebbe from the profits of the stock market great amounts of money. And then the market crashed. The Rebbe was undaunted. There was a depression that had begun, but the Rebbe continued on, for life had to continue, and the Lubavitcher Rebbe had to establish a Lubavitcher yeshiva. So he came to different cities, including the great city of Detroit, in the area where I've been residing for 32 years. He came in 1930, after which there was a large percentage, about 19% of the populace was out of work, where many businesses had failed. People did not know what they were going to do, how they were going to get their next meal. And yet the Rebbe came, offered encouragement, looking for funds from those who could have, who had to share. In Detroit, there was one man who knew the Rebbe from Lubavitch. His name was Max Osnes, the owner of Sam's 5 and 10. Max would have been most honored if the Rebbe would come and visit his home. And for that, Max was willing to give the Rebbe $25,000. He said so to the Rebbe's interpreter, Izzy Starr, who later became one of the successful and important attorneys in Detroit. Izzy came and talked to the Rebbe's secretary. The Rebbe's secretary explained that the Rebbe doesn't eat in private homes, and that was impossible. That was the protocol the Rebbe had established, and the Rebbe wouldn't change it. Max Osnes understood. And then he said, you know what, let him just visit me for a glass of tea, and I'll give the Rebbe $100,000. $100,000. It's a lot of money then. Nobody had it. The equivalent of many millions of dollars in today's dollars. But it wasn't just the equivalency. It was nobody had money. And here was a man who had money, willing to give it to the Rebbe for his yeshiva. And in fact, a study of the Rebbe's finances showed that this would have covered the Rebbe's deficit for the next 10 years. The Rebbe ran a tight ship. This time, Izzy Starr did not go to the secretary. He went directly to the Lubavitcher Rebbe himself. And he said in Yiddish, Rebbe, Moshe Asnes is great given dem Rebbe. $100,000, the Rebbe will trinken bei ma glos tei. Translated, Rebbe, Max Osnes is ready to give you $100,000 if you come visit his house and drink a glass of tea with him. The Rebbe was in a state of contemplation, and after a few seconds says, no, I'm not going to go. And Izzy Starr went out of his mind. Rebbe, why? The Rebbe needs money. You need a yeshiva, you need to make money for the yeshiva. And the Rebbe answered. Max Osnes isn't the only person that I know from Lubavitch. There are dozens of others who know me from Lubavitch that live in the city of Detroit. And many of them are much more religious than Mr. Osnes, who's a fine man, but they keep the Torah much, much better with great self-sacrifice. What will they say if I visit Max? They'll say, the Rebbe doesn't care about my Yiddishkeit. I sacrifice for my Yiddishkeit, for my Shabbos, for my Kashrus, for my education of my children. The Rebbe doesn't care about that. He only cares to visit Max Osnes because Max has got money. You know what's going to happen? That will affect negatively on that man's keeping of Shabbos and eating of kosher. Better I should not get the money and not affect that other person negatively. And that, my friends, is the true characteristic of King David. His devotion to his flock was unconditional. You can just imagine King David needing to collect monies for public works, but in the process would turn a person off. And King David would not have done that project, because in creating a project for people, it cannot be built upon someone else's discomfort and someone else being turned off to God and to God's Torah. You cannot build Torah with something that affects and impacts other people negatively. No matter what the motive, no matter what the result, you have to have in mind how it will affect other people. The Lubavitch Rebbe never got the money, but he did build the Lubavitch Yeshiva. And let me tell you something as a postscript. Four great Rebbes were saved from Europe by miraculous activities and self-sacrifice. The Lubavitcher Rebbe, the Gerer Rebbe, the Belzer Rebbe, and the Satmar Rebbe. All four had miracles take place that intervened to save their lives. Of the four Rebbes, only one had no incidental negative effect upon another Jewish life. The other three, others had to die in order for them to be saved. It was not their fault, but that was the reality. They were saved and others died. Lubavitcher Rebbe was saved and there was no one else who was negatively affected. The reason for that, he was saved by the Abwehr, the German secret police who spirited him out of Warsaw to Berlin, got him from Berlin to Riga. From Riga he took a ship to Stockholm and then came to New York and started again his new career in transforming America. But there was no ancillary negative effect upon a Jewish life. Jewish life, a Jewish treasure did not have to be lost to save the Rebbe. The reason for that was because of the Rebbe's total devotion, that anything that he did would never negatively impact another Jew. That is the nature of King David, to be fearless and totally devoted to the flock and believing that everything comes from God under all circumstances. Contrast that with Jesus, contrast that with the other imposters. That's a false messiah. Not someone who is fearless, not someone who's totally devoted to the flock of Israel.